The world is running out of drinking water, and no one knows that better than Australia. So what if we could take the stuff that we normally flush down the toilet and make it safe to drink? And if we did, then what would it taste like?
I've come to the Beanyup Water Resource Recovery Facility in Perth, Australia to find out. Generally speaking, mixing wastewater and drinking water is a terrible idea. In 1858, physician John Snow discovered that human waste contains pathogens, which can jump from person to person through contaminated drinking water. He was worried about cholera, but we've since discovered a whole host of other nasties in there as well. This sparked a new wave of sewer innovation, starting with just dumping our effluent further and further out, but eventually leading to the high-tech wastewater recycling plants of today. Of course, nowadays there's a lot more than just pee, represented by some cordial, and poop, some gas station meat pies, that our sewer systems have to deal with. Over the course of the day, your typical dinky diozzy will also flush down about 100 grams of toilet paper, food scraps, grease, oil, cleaning chemicals, medicine, and plastic toys. It all gets mixed in with 350 litres of water. Getting the waste out of our water is difficult. We're dealing with physical, chemical, and biological contaminants ranging in size from the centimetre to the picometer, requiring a filtration system that's just as varied. Which is, of course, what brings us back to Beanyup. Our journey begins here at the Inflow pipe. It's currently about 8 a.m, coming up to peak poop time, so there's a 250,000 litres of raw untreated sewage, known as influent, passing beneath my feet every single minute. You can see the line splits into two. That allows them to turn off half the facility if it needs to undergo maintenance. Today though, everything's running. Our plant has a lot of delicate machinery, which would really prefer that we don't go shove a plastic shark through it. So to ensure that it's protected, our first stop is the screening room. Here we've got a series of sieves, which filter out anything larger than about a centimetre. It gets captured and brought up along this conveyor belt before being dumped out and sent for disposal. We've got some cloths, wipes, fabric, and other detritus, which we want to capture before it goes onto the facility. Right now, our solution is a churned up mash of constituents. We've got no hope of making it safe to drink. But if you let it sit for a moment, things start to separate. In the real world, we can't just tell people to stop flushing the toilet in order to let our solution settle out. So instead, here in the sedimentation tank, we do the next best thing. It relies on two key principles: volumetric flow and the conservation of mass. Conservation of mass tells us that all of the water flowing into the tank through the inlet pipe also has to be travelling through the tank itself. We can approximate this as volume in equals volume out. Volumetric flow rate is given by cross-sectional area times flow velocity. Since the tank has a much larger cross-sectional area than the inlet pipe, this means that its flow is correspondingly slower. The water crawls along at a pace of just half a centimetre a second, giving it more than enough time to separate out based on density. Denser solids, known as sludge, sink to the bottom, while less dense oils rise to the top. In some places, these oils can be repurposed to fuel cars, although here, both the oil and sludge are combined and sent to the digester. Sludge processing takes place here, inside the appropriately named anaerobic digesters. Anaerobic because there's no oxygen, and digester because, well, the things inside are being digested. Basically, they're massive mechanical stomachs. The gut bacteria inside you right now will eventually make their way through the sewer system and retire in a tank just like this one. Here, they'll continue the processes of digestion just outside of your body. They break down toxic chemicals into a form that's safe enough to be sold as fertilizer. One of the byproducts of the digestion of organic matter is methane gas, effectively farts. It gets stored in these giant spherical orbs before being burned on site to produce electricity. In all, it offsets about a quarter of the plant's energy needs. Now that we've seen where the solids end up, let's rejoin the fluid stream to try and make some fresh drinking water. These are the aeration tanks. Just like with the digester, we're tricking human bacteria to continue the digestion process for us. Except for these ones, rather than messing around with temperature, instead we're increasing the oxygen content, aerating the mix by pumping air through it. This is the settling tank. You'll notice that it's completely uncovered and has a family of ducks living on it. That's encouraging because it tells us that it's safe enough for animals to live in and it doesn't smell too bad. Water is released here and then gradually flows out to the edges, where the solids fall to the bottom and a couple of the lighter things float to the top, where they're scraped out with a scraper that moves around the circle. As you'll recall, the sun is a deadly laser, so by being directly exposed to sunlight, weak single-celled organisms are killed and able to be deactivated. While you still wouldn't want to drink this, it's about as safe as river water. In some places, this water really is just dumped into rivers. Although in Australia, sending it a couple of kilometres out to sea using massive pipes is a bit more common. Today though, our destination is a bit more exciting. By this stage, we've already removed most of the contaminants and have sent the water through a number of filters to remove all of the big stuff that still remains. Here though is where things get pretty serious. This is ultrafiltration. We force the water through holes 0.03 microns in diameter, which removes any of the organic contaminants, like bacteria and viruses. To get it to work at scale, we use tubes 2 meters long and pepper them with millions of these holes. We then bundle 10,000 of the tubes together and stack them inside one of these cylinders. With 500 of the cylinders working in parallel, we can produce 1,600 liters of water every single second. Reverse osmosis dials things up to 11. The sound you're hearing is a high-pressure pump used to raise water pressure to 6.5 bar. That's enough to force it through the semi-permeable membrane, with holes 100 times smaller than those used in ultrafiltration. When used in a desalination plant, a piece like this would be used to remove the sodium and chlorine ions. But here, it's removing any of the remaining contaminants and also takes out pretty much all of the dissolved minerals. Now, 6.5 bar might sound like a lot, but that's an order of magnitude less than used in desalination. We can get away with these lower pressures because there's a lot less contaminants that we're trying to remove. Finally, just to be extra safe, the water passes through these ultra-bright UV lamps. These lamps will kill any pathogens which made it through the previous steps. We're now approaching the end of our journey. From here, the water will be pumped underground into an awaiting aquifer. It'll stay there for a couple of years before being pumped back out to be used as drinking water. We call this an environmental buffer, and you could do something similar by putting the water into a lake or a reservoir. As for our recycled water, well, it's perfectly clear and doesn't smell of anything. Actually, because it's so clean, we need to redissolve some minerals back into it in order for it to be safe. So remove a bit of the too clean water and put in some regular tap water. As for what it tastes like, well, oh, that's really good. Just what you need on a hot day. Just tastes like perfectly pure water. Until next time, this has been James Dingley from the Atomic Frontier. Keep looking up. Oh, that's really good. Ahoy there, it is I, Captain Sailout. Wastewater treatment is incredible, but just getting your poop into the sewer is a major feat of engineering. Specifically this one, the toilet. Fortunately, today's sponsor, Brilliant, has an incredible online interactive course for free right now on toilet design. I enjoyed learning about the toilet while on one. Brilliant is where you learn by doing, with thousands of interactive classes in science, math, programming, and AI. Brilliant's recent course on how technology works lets you inside the science of the everyday. Learn how to bury your treasure under a strong password, how to use GPS to plot where you are at sea, and discover why streaming YouTube videos from the bottom of Davy Jones's locker is a bad idea. To try everything that Brilliant has on offer for free for a full 30 days, or to get 20% off their premium annual subscription, sail over to brilliant.org/atomicfrontier, or check the link in the description.